And here, of course, like this work is related to the work which I did in my postdoc during my visit to Canada. So there, university of reason. So the title of the talk is graphs with simply structured eigenvector. So here, simply structured eigenvector, I'll mean that eigenvector can be constructed using the entries 1, minus 1, and 0. So if you have all the eigenvectors with entries 1, minus 1, and 0, I'll tell it as simply structured eigenvector. Graphs with simply structured eigenvector. So we'll go to that class, but before that, of course, like I have to use tell the notation that I'll use here. So I'm taking a simple graph. Of course, the things can be generalized to directed graph, and for this talk I'm just keeping the things for simple graph. And we have a graph with n vertices, so then like adjacency matrix that we know already, it's a 0-1 matrix, and we put one adjacent vertices that we know when the graph is simple graph. And then the simple definition that has been given for Laplacian, this is DG minus AG. So DG is here the diagonal matrix with diagonal entries as vertex degree. So the way it has been defined, it's again symmetric matrix. So also one can prove that this is a positive semidefinite matrix. So both the matrix have real eigenvalues, we can order them. So whenever I'll list the eigenvalues of AG, that is the adjacency matrix, I'll denote by sigma G. And always I start with lambda 1, that is the smallest one, and then I'll go for the largest. So that way I order. And when I'll say SC, that is the notation I'll use for Laplacian eigenvalues, and I'll again order the eigenvalues from lambda 1 to lambda G. So the way Laplacian has been defined, you can see that the diagonal entries you are taking degrees, and if in each row you can see that those many, like whatever the degree, those many minus ones will come. So automatically if you take the row sum for each row, it's giving you zero. So you can say that zero is coming as one eigenvalue, and the corresponding eigenvector will be the all ones vector. Okay, so here, like looking at this all ones vector, you can see that this vector has been constructed using only one. So, and this is one eigenvalue, zero is one eigenvalue here. And that will be the smallest eigenvalue because, as I told, the Laplacian is a positive semidefinite matrix. So, the also we know that the second smallest eigenvalue, when it is positive, the graph has to be connected. That's a if and only condition. So, I'm not going towards this. So, I'll look for my eigenvectors because that's what I'm targeting here. Before that, let's see one example. So this example I have drawn, and I have colored also the vertices some. And in this, like looking at the graph, you can see that one thing I can say directly, like it's colored and it has 16 vertices. And if I see each vertex has degree 7. So it's a 7 regular graph. And you can see also that if I look for these 4 vertices, C1, C2, C3, C4, they form a, like if I look at the induced subgraph, and that's a complete graph of order 4. Similarly, C5, C6, C7, C8, that's forming a complete graph of order 4. So I have used 4 colors to color them. Why I did that, that I'll tell you. But this graph is not a new graph. This is a Sudoku graph. So if you take a 2 to the power 4 cell Sudoku, then the graph we can draw like this, and the coloring I have given just solving it the puzzle has, means that the solution accordingly I have put the color, and that way they are related, the Sudoku graph and the Sudoku puzzle. So one nice thing here is, of course, that this graph is it's a regular graph of regularity 7. So I can say that 7 will be one eigenvalue, and that will be of multiplicity 1 because of parent value. And the graph is connected, that's why. So 7 is one eigenvalue coming once, and 3 is one eigenvalue that is coming twice. 1 is one eigenvalue coming 4 times, minus 1 coming 5 times, and minus 3 coming 4 times. So all the eigenvalues here integers. Okay, and what is Sudoku graph? I'll go to the definition. So Sudoku graph is, if you have a Sudoku of n to the power 4 cells, then you can connect to a Sudoku graph that is defined like, it has n to the power 4 vertices, and it is obtained from the Sudoku. And what it's doing, actually the Sudoku has n to the power 4 cells, then you have to take each cell as a vertex, and two vertices there will be adjacent if and only if the corresponding cells in the Sudoku, they are situated in the same row or same column or same block. Like here I have taken a 2 to the power 4 cell Sudoku, so I'll denote that way like Sudoku of order 2. So, but it has, you can see it has 2 to the power 4 vertices, so 16 vertices. Now see the Sudoku, it has 4 blocks. So this is one block, this is one block, this is one block, this is one block. So the Sudoku puzzle, when we solve, we basically we have a n square block, like in your usual Sudoku it's 9. So each block is with 9 cells, and then you fill up from 1 to 9, and somehow you make it in such a way that all cells, they get distinct numbers. So here this is, I have taken 2 to the power 4 cells, so I have 4 blocks, and then I can connect to a graph. So the graph is defined in this way. You have 16 cells. So 16 cells I have named like C1, C2, C3, C4, and then C5, C6, like that. So you can see the adjacency here defined in this way, that if two cells are in the same row or same column, they will be adjacent. And if they are in the same block, then also they will be adjacent. So one will be adjacent to 2. One will be adjacent to 3, one will be adjacent to 4, again one will be adjacent to 3 because they are in the same column, one will be it's not 3, it's my C5. So this is C1, C2, I am looking for the cells, so this is C1, C2, so C1 is adjacent to C2, C3, C4, again it will be adjacent to C5, this is C9 and C13. And since this one and this one in the same block, so C1 is adjacent to this one, this is your C6. So accordingly I have drawn the graph. You can see C1 is connected to C2, C3, C4, and it will be connected to C5 and 9 and also 13, and it will be connected to C6 because they are in the same cell. So it has degree 7. Accordingly all other vertices I have connected. But the Sudoku has been solved here, okay, and accordingly the entries, same entry I have given, same color, you can see the solution here. So that way Sudoku graphs are useful, just taking the coloring. So when you are looking for a solution for a Sudoku of n to the power 4 cells, actually you have to take the Sudoku graph and give a proper coloring, because, and you have to use those many colors that is here, I'm taking a 2 to the power 4 number of cells, so I have 2 to the power 4 colors I have to use, because this forms a complete graph here, these 4 form complete graph, so I need at least 2 to the power 2 colors, so 4 colors I need here, and those 4 colors I'll use in such a way, I'll give a proper coloring, then your puzzle will be solved accordingly. So that way they are connected, but our concern is not that. Actually I wanted to start with one example, that's why this class and this Sudoku class, as we observe in n equal to 2 case, we have eigenvalues which are all integer eigenvalues, and I used here you can see 5 eigenvalues, 5 distinct eigenvalues are there. And if you take n greater than equal to 3, you need 6 numbers and all 6 integers, and all eigenvalues can be described. So the eigenvalues of a Sudoku graph, they actually are integers, and at most 6 integers you need to describe. And the interesting thing here, if you see the eigenspaces of each eigenvalue, they can be they can have a basis which contains vectors formed by entries minus 1, 0, 1. So they have the eigenvectors, all the eigenvectors you can form using the entries minus 1, 0, 1. So that's a class which, like I told, it's a simply structured eigenvectors they have. So Sudoku graphs have simply structured eigenvectors. So this is one class that I told. But we'll go for which other graph. So this is the question. That which graph does admit a simply structured eigenspace basis? So that means I'm looking for eigenvectors. All eigenvectors should be described using minus 1 and 0, 1 entry. So that is helpful when we analyze the eigenvectors. So of course the Laplacian eigenvectors, they are useful, and when they analyze the eigenvectors, so if the eigenvectors are structurally simple, then it will be helpful. Now look at adjacency case. As I told, your Sudoku graph came out as a regular graph. So when the graph is regular, your eigenvectors for your adjacency matrix are same as eigenvectors for your Laplacian matrix. So we'll see here that the classes which are basically we are getting are all coming out regular. But first I'll discuss about adjacency case. So when I'm looking for adjacency case and I'm taking a regular graph, let's say, then I know that if it's of regularity R, then we know that all one vector will be one eigenvector corresponding to R, and that's the largest eigenvector. Okay. So here, how the in Laplacian case zero was coming with all one vector, in regular graph, the adjacency matrix should come with all one vector. And we know that all other eigenvectors, they will be orthogonal to this vector or all ones vector. So here in adjacency case, this was the conjecture which was given by Sander in his thesis, that the null space of the adjacency matrix of every forest has a minus 1, 0, 1 basis. So if you look for the eigenvectors corresponding to the zero eigenvalue of any forest, so then you all the eigenvectors, those eigenvectors you can describe using minus 1, 0, 1 entry. And he, in that thesis itself, he answered the question when the nullity is 1. So if you have only 1, 0 eigenvalue, that can be described, its eigenvector can be described using entries minus 1, 0. So this the conjecture that has been proved by these people, Aquari et al., that if you have a forest and then there exists a minus 1, 0, 1 basis for its null space, that means you have a basis with entries, vectors with entries minus 1, 0, 1. And that will happen actually in forest case for the null space. So if you are taking all the eigenvectors corresponding to zero eigenvalue, they can be described using minus 1, 0, 1 entry. So indeed, that will take all the eigenvectors, if you think of, that will take this type of if all the columns you will put, that will form a matrix like this. So this X basically contains minus 1, 0, 1 entries, and then here identity will come. So these are all the basis elements for the null space. So that way it has been. So it's proved there that if you have a forest, then the null space has the basis with eigenvectors which are structurally simple. And then here there is a question that is left for which graphs there is a minus 1, 0, 1 basis for the null space. So it's only proved for the forest, and the question is left for graphs. So if you consider only zero eigenvalue, then which are the graphs for which you can have the eigenvectors minus 1, 0, with minus 1, 0, 1 entry? Now, if I go to co-graphs, co-graphs will come out here interesting. So, what is co-graph? So, a graph that can be constructed from isolated vertices, that means you have to take singleton vertices and then use sequences of operation, those are unions and complements. So you start with a singleton vertex, or you can start with two singleton vertices, and then use the operation union and complements. So whatever the graphs coming out, they are the co-graphs. So I'll describe the definition more like clearly here, but before that, I'll go for the join operation. Join operation, I think you people know, and just I want to express in terms of union and complement. So union, I'm using plus symbol. And join is this one. So two graphs like G and S, we are joining means we just take G and S and put all the edges between the vertices of G and H. That's the join operation. And G join S, that can be expressed in terms of union and complement. So it can be written as G complement, union H complement, whole complement. So once I express join operation in terms of union and complements, I can give the definition for co-graphs in this way. Take a class, let C be the class of graphs, and it's defined in this way that K1 is in C, that is the singleton vertex, that is inside C. And if two graphs, G and H, are in C, then G union H has to be in C, and G join H, that has to be in C. So if one class C is satisfying these three properties, that is basically the class of co-graphs. So co-graphs are defined, as I told. So you are basically using a union and complement. If you want to avoid complement, you can put join there. So I have used here join. You can also replace this property just saying that if G belongs to C, then G complement belongs to C. That can be replaced here, and the same definition it is. So I want to use join because later I'll use join operation. So this is the class. So I have one example here, like you can see. So I just started with two singleton vertices. This is a co-graph. This is a co-graph because they are K1. And I took the union, so this is a co-graph. Now, if I take one edge between them, so basically I'm making the join of two co-graphs, so that is again a co-graph. Now, if I take another vertex, okay, so that is again, this is a co-graph. This is already a co-graph, so the union is the total graph, that is again a co-graph. Again, I can do the join operation, so that's again a co-graph. If I take another two vertices, this is a co-graph, this is a co-graph, this is a co-graph, so the total union is a co-graph. If I want to join, I can join again. And basically, I thought about this co-graph, that is K1 union K1, and the other one is this one, and then I join. So that's a co-graph again. Again, I can take another singleton vertex, so the union is again a co-graph. And if I join, that is again a co-graph. So this way they have been formed. So basically we are using union and join, and we started with singleton vertices. So that way all the co-graph, they these are the few properties that has been proved. So in this paper by Marys, that a graph, this is actually another definition of co-graph, that a graph is co-graph if and only if it doesn't have an induced subgraph isomorphic to P1. So if there is no induced subgraph isomorphic to P1, we can directly say it's a co-graph. And that's happening because it has been constructed using your join operation. So each time when you are making it connected, you are joining. So that way your P4 is going. So that's the thing. So that is this is also one definition. And then the polynomial is one observation that if you have a graph on n greater than or equal to 2 vertices, and you know that G and G complement both are connected, in that case it cannot be a co-graph. So it will have one induced subgraph of, that is isomorphic to P4, so it cannot be a co-graph. So if both G and G complement are connected, then G is not a co-graph. And another observation that is like the way they have been constructed, you can observe that when you are taking a connected co-graph, then basically if G is a connected co-graph, then G can be written as a join of few co-graphs, and those are of lower order. So G can be expressed as G1 join G2 up to GK, and G1, G2, GK, they are again co-graphs of lower order, and that can be proved using induction. So this thing I'll use, that when I'm taking a co-graph, I can always express it in terms of smaller co-graphs, just joining them. Now, what is interesting about co-graphs, it's not only about eigenvectors. If you look at the matrix of a co-graph, this thing is nice, and this was observed by a computer scientist when he was working, and then Royal proved it. And the, if you are taking the co-graph and its adjacency matrix, okay, then if you look at distinct non-zero rows in the co-graph, in any general graph, if you look at the adjacency matrix and look at the distinct non-zero rows, okay, they can be dependent also. They can be linearly dependent. But in co-graph, if you take the distinct non-zero rows, they are all independent, and that will give you the rank. So this is the theorem, that the rank of a co-graph is equal to the number of distinct non-zero rows of AZ. And here the question is again left where the student, they can consider and look for like whatever has been done. So are there any other natural classes of graphs for which this rank property holds, that if you look at distinct non-zero rows, then you can tell about the rank? So anyway, this is about the co-graph that satisfies this nice property, that if you look at the non-zero or distinct rows, then you can say what is the rank directly. And another nice property that Sander observed is every co-graph admits a simply structured eigenspace basis for the eigenvalue 0 and minus 1 with respect to the adjacency matrix. So in co-graph that we have constructed the way like it's coming out from K1s, like a few copies of K1s you are starting with, and then you are moving with union and join. So you can see that 0 will be one eigenvalue, minus 1 will be one eigenvalue. And if you look for the eigenvectors of the eigenvalue 0 and minus 1 for the adjacency matrix, you can have like eigenvectors which are simply structured. Okay, so that was observed by Sander. So for the eigenvalues, eigenvectors corresponding to 0 and minus 1, these two eigenvalues, you can have eigenvectors which can be constructed using 0, 1, and minus 1. And simply structured eigenvector graphs, those graphs, like as I told, there are many, one class I told is Sudoku class, and that is Sudoku graphs. And another class is humming graphs, those are also with eigenvectors, they are simple, with simple eigenvector structure. And you have unitary Kelly graph, those can be also, GCD graphs can be also, and those you can prove easily, because if you take a Sudoku graph, that can be expressed as any PS of complete graphs. You have to choose the right basis. And GCD graphs also can be expressed as any PS of complete graphs. And complete graphs have eigenvectors, you can have eigenvectors using 1 and minus 1 only. So that way you can prove that Sudoku graph, GCD graph, this unitary Kelly graph, they are basically any PS of complete graphs. So they are giving you the simply structured eigenvectors. So we'll move for the Laplacian case. So in Laplacian case, we'll look for I'm starting with a co-graph. Then in co-graph, when you will consider the Laplacian matrix and we'll look for the eigenvectors, you can see that there exists a basis B of eigenvectors of LZ, such that each vector of B has at most two distinct non-zero entries. So using two distinct non-zero entries, you can describe all the eigenvectors of the Laplacian matrix. And that's why it's happening, because it's constructed in that way, that you are using join operation and union operation. So that way it's coming out. So the proof is in the paper, you can see. But using only two entries, you can describe, like two non-zero entries, you can describe all the eigenvectors. But the converse is not true for this theorem, because you have certain graphs which are like for which you can describe the eigenvectors using two non-zero entries. but they are not co-graphs. Like here we have a class, you can say, like if I'm taking a connected graph and G, and then if I do the Cartesian product of G with the complete graph of order 2, that's not a co-graph. We can prove it. And but in particular case, if I take G equal to let's say C4, so C4 has eigenvectors in this way. So these are the eigenvectors. So they are basically described in using 1 and minus 1. And when I'm taking the Cartesian product of C4 with K2, then you can you know the eigenvectors, they are basically tensor product of the eigenvectors of C4 and K2. So they will come out again with entries 1 and minus 1 only. Okay, so Cartesian product, who I think you people know, otherwise it's just like if you are taking two graphs G and H, then the Cartesian product graph has vertex set as VG cross BH, that is the Cartesian product of the vertex sets. So it will give you pairs and two vertices, they will look like this, UV, U is from G and V is from H. Similarly, U dash B dash, two vertices, they are adjacent in your product graph. If either first two coordinates are equal and second two coordinates are adjacent, or first two coordinates are adjacent in your first graph and second two coordinates are equal. So if this happens, then you will put your edge. So accordingly, this graph I have made. So this is C4 and C4 Cartesian product gate. So I just wanted to give one example here that the converse is not true. So this is not a co-graph. And this has eigenvectors, all the eigenvectors you can describe using only two non-zero entries, that is 1 and minus 1. So like as we know, all ones vector is one eigenvector for your Laplacian matrix for any graph G. So let us, and we observe that we have graphs for which we can construct the eigenvectors only using two non-zero entries. So I'll consider 1 and minus 1, and I'll just exclude the 0. So we started that we are looking for graphs with simply structured eigenvector. That means we will allow entries as 0, 1, minus 1. Let us exclude 0 and look for a characterization of all graphs for which there exists a basis B of eigenvectors of LG, such that each vector of B has entries either plus 1 or minus 1. So I'm not allowing 0 here. So for that, we are defining graphs with property E. So a graph has property E if for each eigenvalue lambda of LG, there is a corresponding eigenvector with every entry equal to plus 1 or minus 1. So this is the property E. And such graphs exist because you saw example also. Now, when I'm looking for such graphs that all the eigenvectors, they can be described using plus 1 or minus 1. Of course, then if I look, like if I put them in a matrix, all the columns as my eigenvector, so somehow they will look like a Hadamard matrix. So it's not always true that they will satisfy the Hadamard matrix condition, but somehow it will give me a matrix which will have entries plus 1 and minus 1. So look at the Hadamard matrix, that is Hadamard matrix definition says that if you have a matrix that is n cross n matrix and all the entries are either plus 1 or minus 1, then we call it Hadamard matrix if H into H transpose is n times identity. That means it has all the entries plus 1 or minus 1, and if you are taking two columns or two rows, distinct rows or distinct columns, they are orthogonal to each other, and the inner product of any row with itself is giving you n. So that's the definition of Hadamard matrix. So the way it has been defined, basically you can observe that it should have even order. Why? That I'll tell you. So that is normalized Hadamard matrix. It is always possible to arrange or permute your rows and column, and then you can have a matrix that is having your first row is all ones, all positive ones, and first column is all positive ones. So that way you can make it just by permutation, using some permutation, just intuition, and or you can multiply minus one somewhere in some column or some row. So always it's possible that if you have a Hadamard matrix, you can bring it to a matrix where that's again Hadamard, and its first row and first column are plus one entries. So that's called a normalized Hadamard matrix. So here I have given one example. This matrix, you can see here all the entries are either plus one or minus one, and if you take the inner product with any two rows or any two columns, you can get zero. So it's satisfying H into H transpose n times identity. So this is a Hadamard matrix, but look at this one. I just this is all ones, like all positive ones here in this column, all positive ones in this row, but I took to the first row and first column just doing the permutation, and you can multiply also minus one to some rows and column. So you can bring to this form. This is called the normalized Hadamard matrix. I wanted to bring to this form because I know that if I look for eigenvectors, then I know that my first eigenvector that is corresponding to zero eigenvalue in case of Laplacian, that that has all ones. That all the entries are positive ones, so that way we made it. So as I told, when you are taking Hadamard matrix, order has to be even because you have such type of like all ones vector also, and then some other column that has to be orthogonal to it. So obviously the other columns, they have half ones and half minus ones, and in that case like you can say that it's it has to be even order. And similarly, if you proceed another step, you can also prove that if you are considering a Hadamard matrix of order n greater than equal to 4, then it should be of the form 4k. So that's the necessary condition for the existence of Hadamard matrix, that n has to be 1 or 2 or 4k for some integer k. And Hadamard conjecture tells that if you take n equal to 1, 2 and 4k, there exists Hadamard matrix. Okay. But this conjecture has not been proved. And for large k, like that means large n, Hadamard matrices have been constructed for n equal to 4k. So this has not been disproved also. So this is a conjecture. So when you are looking for Hadamard matrices, so either n equal to 1, n equal to 2 or n equal to 4k for some integer k. So then because we were looking for graphs with eigenvectors having entries 1 and minus 1. So here I am defining this that a graph G is said to be Hadamard diagonalizable if there is a Hadamard matrix H that diagonalizes LG. Okay. So in that case, obviously your graph will satisfy your property E, that is all the eigenvectors will have entries plus 1 or minus 1. So this is the definition, that Hadamard diagonalizer. Then you have a Hadamard matrix that will diagonalize LG. And we have examples that if you look for order 2, so K2 will satisfy this, and K2 complement also will satisfy this. And if I go for like next number, that is 4, then there is Hadamard matrix. So if I look for order 4, then the empty graph, that is the complement of K4, and the complete bipartite graph with half vertices, that is 2, 2 in both part, that is K2, 2, that will satisfy also its complement, that is K2 union K2. So these four graphs will be Hadamard diagonalizable when n equal to 4. And as I told, when I'm taking a Hadamard diagonalizable graph, that is with property E. Because in Hadamard diagonalizable graphs, again eigenvectors, they satisfy extra condition that if you are taking the matrix, H into H transpose is giving you n into identity. So that's the extra condition, including that plus minus one. Now this result tells that if a graph G is Hadamard diagonalizable, then it can be also diagonalizable by a normalized Hadamard matrix. So this is the if and only if condition. So G is Hadamard diagonalizable if and only if there is a normalized Hadamard matrix that diagonalizes LG. So we'll look for the normalized Hadamard matrices, and then we'll look for the graphs which are getting diagonalized by those normalized Hadamard matrices. So the first observation that we got, that if you have a normalized Hadamard matrix of order 4k, then your complete graph of order 4k is diagonalizable by H. So if you are taking any normalized Hadamard matrix, your complete graph will be diagonalizable by H. And you can just permute the matrix, and you can have a permutation. Always there exists a permutation matrix P. So the PH will diagonalize the complete bipartite graph with 2k, 2k vertices, that is k, 2k, 2k. Okay. So Kn is always Hadamard diagonalizable for n equal to 4k. And the complete bipartite graph with the partition, that is also diagonalizable by Hadamard diagonalizable by one normalized Hadamard matrix. Just you have to form. So these two are the graph, then their complement will be also Hadamard diagonalizable, that we can observe. So always we can say that the empty graph with 4k vertices and the complete graph and a complete bipartite graph and its complement, they are always Hadamard diagonalizable. And the nice result this came out, that made things again simpler, means it went to a smaller class, that if G is a Hadamard diagonalizable graph, then G must be a regular graph. So from the class of like we were roaming with any graph, then we came to the regular class. And also this condition is there, that all its eigenvalues will be integer eigenvalue and they will be even integer eigenvalue. So this is a nice thing, that if you are taking a Hadamard diagonalizable graph, it has to be regular and it has even integer eigenvalues. Then we considered regular classes basically. And we tried to use some operation, that whether we can use operation and then we can go for the construction. So the first operation one can think of, that that is union. So whether we can take two Hadamard diagonalizable graphs and then we can construct another by just taking the union, that's not possible, because if you can see this result, that if we are taking G1, G2, B two non-empty graphs, and let's say G1 plus G2, that is the G1 union G2, that is Hadamard diagonalizable, then both G1 and G2, they have to be regular graphs of same order, same regularity. And G1, G2 both should have even eigenvalues, and G1, G2 both should share the eigenvalues, same eigenvalues. Okay, so in that case, basically we started with taking G union G. So if you are taking the same graph and then you are making this union, then you can say that your next graph will be a Hadamard diagonalizable graph. So if G is a Hadamard diagonalizable graph and you are taking a G complement, then it will be Hadamard diagonalizable. And if you are taking G union G, that will be Hadamard diagonalizable, and G join G will be Hadamard diagonalizable. And if you are considering any two graphs, they are Hadamard diagonalizable, like G1, G2. Then if you consider the Cartesian product of G1 and G2, that will be Hadamard diagonalizable. Also, the lexicographic product is working. Oh, here I have not mentioned, I'll use this one, that Cartesian product thing for construction. That's why I mentioned. So if you are taking G1 and G2 and both are Hadamard diagonalizable, take the Cartesian product of them, that will be Hadamard diagonalizable again. So using this basically, and the proving this was not easy, but anyway, so if you look for n equal to 8, so that is the next number, so in n equal to 4 there were 4 graphs only, and if you look for n equal to 8, so then we have 10 graphs which are Hadamard diagonalizable. These are the 10 graphs. So I have listed here. One is this is complete graph complement. That means this is the empty graph, and complete graph is coming also. Okay, and then complete bipartite graph will come, and its complement will come. This one, and then other graphs. You can see the 10 graphs. I mean, other 6 graphs. They are constructed basically the way I have written. They all are constructed using union operation, join operation, and the Cartesian product operation from the complete graphs. Okay, either I have used K2 or K4, and then some operation I have used. So all the graphs, they are obtained in that way. And so these are the 10 graphs which are of order 8, and they are Hadamard diagonalism, and they are the only graphs which are Hadamard diagonalism. So in case of n equal to 8, we have 10 graphs. And when we look for the next number, that is 12, so in case of 12, only 4 graphs came out. As I told, these 4 has to be like always they will be like when you are taking 4k, these 4 graphs will be Hadamard diagonalism always, and these 4 came out in case of order 12. So this is complete graph, its complement, and the complete bipartite graph with same partition and its complement. So these 4 are Hadamard diagonalism when you are considering n equal to 12. And then going for 16 was not easy, because for 16 you don't have, like, you don't know how many Hadamard matrices are there. And even you know the number, it's not easy to look for those Hadamard matrices. But my project student, he did for n equal to 16. And one of the project student, he did, and exactly 50 graphs they came out. But proof was basically difficult. Computationally you can find out, but to argue that those are the 50 graphs which will satisfy that property, it was difficult, because for 8 and 12 we had long arguments we gave. So now we targeted, because we know that co-graphs, they are all the eigenvectors, they can be described using 2 non-zero entries. That was our first observation. So we looked for co-graphs which are either with property E, or then we'll move to Hadamard diagonalizable thing. So first we targeted that which regular co-graphs are with property E. Okay. So as I told in the beginning, when I'm looking for a co-graph which is connected, that will take this form, that can be written in this way, that G1 join G2 and join GK, and the GI all will be again co-graphs. So let G equal to G1 join G2 join GK be a regular connected co-graph, and let it satisfies property E. Okay, that means all the eigenvector, they can be described using plus 1 or minus 1. Then what we observed, your G1, G2 up to GK all should be regular co-graph of same order and of same degree of regularity. So they must be with same number of vertices, and also they are regular and with same degree of regularity. Further, they all should share the same eigenvalues. They have the same eigenvalues. So they will share the eigenvalues, same eigenvalues. And the next result then made it easy, because when you take 2 connected regular co-graph, G1 and G2, and let they satisfy property E. So if G1 and G2 be 2 connected regular co-graphs with property E, and n is greater than equal to, with n greater than equal to 2 vertices, then if they share the spectrum, that means if the spectrum of G1 is same as spectrum of G2, then G1 must be equal to G2. Okay, so when you are taking a regular co-graph and then you are saying that it satisfies property E, that's basically looking like G1 join G1 for some co-graph GU. So that form it will take. These all have to be same. So then this is the construction of all co-graphs which satisfy, all regular co-graphs which satisfy property E. And that gives a penal condition. So this is one construction that you start with S0. So S0 contains complete graphs of even order. So you can take m greater than or equal to 2 and put all the km. So complete graph. So you can put your k2, k4, all these. So that is your set S0. So S0 consists of all complete graphs of even order. And then for I in your natural number set, so I equal to 1, 2, up to like you have to continue. Si is defined in this way recursively, that Si equal to G complement join G complement. You have to take many copies of G, and G belongs to Si minus 1. And the join that we are doing, how many copies we are taking? We are taking even number of copies always. So Si basically formed by taking graphs from Si minus 1 and you are joining some even number of copies. So that way recursively this class is S0, S1, S2, all these you have to you can get. So like here I have given example. So I can take G0. G0 is K2, let's say. And that is a complete graph of even order. So that lies in S0. So next I can construct another graph, that is G1. G1 is I'm taking G0 complement, G0 complement. I took two copies and just made the join. So that's a graph coming out that is basically C4, and that will lie in your S1. Okay, you can take four copies also. You can take 8 copies. You have to take even number of copies and then you can construct one graph, and that will be here. So when you are using one graph that is from S0 and then you are joining even number of copies of its complement, then which graph is coming? That is lying here in S1. Now in S1 your C4 is there. Then if you form another graph, let's say G2, and you are taking C4 complement, join C4 complement 4 times, like you have made 4 copies join together, then this graph G2 will lie in S2. Okay, and there can be like you can take more copies, but you have to take even number of copies always, and the new graph that will come out that will be here in S2. Similarly, one can proceed. So your S0, S1 that you can construct in this way recursively. And then this theorem tells that gamma is a regular cograph with property E on n greater than or equal to 2 vertices if and only if gamma lies in Si for some I. Okay, I equal to 0 to 1. So this is the if and only condition, that a regular cograph that will satisfy property E, then it will look like this thing. So it will lie in S0 union S1 union S2 in that set. Okay, so this is a complete characterization of regular cographs that satisfy property E. That means all the eigenvectors can be described using plus 1 or minus 1. Also, this result, like the next one, that if you are taking a connected regular cograph, then there exists a basis of 1 minus 1 eigenvector. So you can have a orthogonal set of n eigenvectors for the Laplacian if and only if G lies in Si. So this class is basically giving you full set of eigenvectors constructed that is the orthogonal set, and that can be constructed using plus 1 and minus 1. This is about property E, but when we are looking for the Hadamard diagonalizable graph, so basically it should be diagonalized by a Hadamard matrix. Hadamard matrix satisfy again the other properties. So it is two columns are orthogonal to each other, and that thing is there. So now just observe the graphs which are in Si. Okay, so if I am taking a graph gamma, and gamma is lying inside Si, then it's related to you can see if it's lying in Si, then it will be related to a unique I plus 1 tuple, means of even integers. Okay, so that means you are when you are taking a graph gamma in Si, gamma is associated with I plus 1 even integers. Okay, why? Because when you started, let's say gamma is in S0, so you gamma will look like KM0. So M0 is even unit. So it's a even complete graph when it's lying in S0. So it's associated with M0, that is one even number. And when you are going for gamma in SI, so it should be constructed from some gamma 1 that lies in your SI minus 1. Okay, so and then you are taking even number of copies of gamma 1 complement, and then you are, let's say, MI copies you are taking, and then you are making join. Okay, that way you are obtaining your gamma. So, and gamma 1 again lies in SI minus 1, so that has been constructed again using a graph from SI minus 2, and that that graph has been constructed in the previous. So, that way you can say that gamma 1 complement is. Or here complement, I should not write, this is gamma 1 I can denote. So gamma 1 is depending on M0, M1 up to MI minus 1. So gamma is depending on M0, M1 up to MI minus 1 and also MI, because you have taken MI copy. So each time you are taking a gamma, if it's lying in SI, it's associated with your even numbers M0, M1, MI. So you can say that each gamma in SI, there is a unique I plus 1 tuple of even integers which are associated with gamma. So the way it has been constructed, like if you are taking gamma in your SI, the way we constructed, we can see that if you are taking gamma in SI, so basically I'm denoting in this way, so G M0 M1 to MI, that means this graph is lying in SI, has exactly I plus 2 distinct eigenvalues. So that can be proved. Okay, so it will have exactly I plus 2 distinct eigenvalues. And here, I have given the complete eigenspaces for each eigenvalue, and this theorem I don't want to read. It's basically you have your I plus 2 distinct eigenvalues. First eigenvalue is 0, that you know, and all others are listed in this way. And then you can get the dimension of the eigenspace for each eigenvalue, and also the eigenvectors has been described in this result. So I'm skipping this. I'll just go for the Hadamard thing. So this is one of the important theorem that we got, that if we are taking a even integer, let's say M0, M1 and MI, such that G M0, M1, MI, this is basically lying, this notation means this graph is in SI. So this graph is Hadamard diagonalizable graph. Okay. So I'm taking M0, M1, these are even numbers, and then forming one graph. That graph is in SI, and that I'm taking is Hadamard diagonalizable graph. Then what will happen, that is interesting, then for each k equal to 0, 1 to I, there exists a Hadamard matrix of order pi j equal to k to I mj. So it will start, the multiplication is starting from mk to mi. So you will take k equal to 0, then it will have more terms otherwise. So for each such order, you have a Hadamard matrix. So if you are saying that this graph is Hadamard diagonalizable, then for each k, you will get this number. So for each number, there will be one Hadamard matrix. Okay. And what we are suspecting here is the converse is true. For this theorem, the converse will come out true. And if the converse is true, then we can characterize all the Hadamard diagonalizable co-graphs. Okay, that will be completely done. But again, it's depending on if this has been if this is happening, then this is happening. So it's depending on Hadamard conjecture again. Anyway, we are the converse we have not proved here, so that's still open. But we are guessing that converse will be true. And the recent development which are done in this angle are as I told in the while discussing, if you are taking n even and you have a Hadamard matrix of order n, because we don't know, that's a conjecture basically. If n equal to 4k, then there will be one Hadamard matrix. So if there exists a Hadamard matrix of order n, then we know that these four graphs are always Hadamard diagonalizable. Okay, so kn and its complement, the complete bipartite graph with n by 2 partition and its complement. So these four are Hadamard diagonalizable that we know, okay, if there exists a Hadamard matrix of order n. So this is the nice result that came out recently, and they have just submitted the paper, and it's in archive, you can see. So this is a large group, starting with Green, Butler, and those people. So around 10 people are here. So they have, in this paper, they have gone, they have given a good algorithm, and I don't know, it's a it will be verified and it's actually correct or not, but they have given an efficient algorithm that can construct all Hadamard diagonalizable of order 4k, and using that up to order 36 they have constructed all the Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. And the nice result they proved that then makes things easy, that if you are taking a graph of order n, and n is 8k, n is of this form 8k plus 4, that means 4 into some odd integer, like our 12 case, then there are only 4 Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. Those are these graphs, so kn and complete bipartite graph and their complement. So these 4 will be the only Hadamard diagonalizable graphs if n is of the form 4 into some odd number. Otherwise, they have the algorithm, and using that they have constructed. So I'll go for this one. You can see the table. Actually, Hadamard matrices, again, there are many. When you are increasing the order, if you look for non-equivalent Hadamard matrices. So here, equivalent Hadamard matrices means one Hadamard matrix, if it can be formed using some permutations of rows or columns, or you are just multiplying minus one to some row or column, that way if two Hadamard matrices can be formed one from another, then they are equivalent basically. So here I'm taking non-equivalent Hadamard matrices, so the number is already obtained, so that's in literature. So for 4, there is only a single Hadamard matrix, and as we observe, there are 4 Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. And now if I look for 4 into some odd number, so that is the next number is 12, you will get 4 Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. Also for 20, again this is 4 into 5, so this is the 4 graphs only. And if you look for 28, also 4 graphs, 36, also 4 graphs. So these are numbers of that type, 4 into some odd integer. So then you have 4 graphs only. And if you look for 8, as I told, there are 10 graphs. For 16, we had calculated, also they have calculated there and described all the graphs. Those are 50. And when you are going for 24, number is decreasing. And why it's decreasing? That because here 3 is coming. This is a 2 to the power something, 16. And again, 32 is 2 to the power something. So when our number is there in the multiple, 24, 3 is coming. Here the number is decreasing, then it's 26. Okay, so they have described which graphs will come out. And for 32, again, number of Hadamard matrices is much more. And in that case, you have a large number of Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. Okay, so this is up to 32, I have mentioned here. One can go for large numbers. In other directions, if you see, then what has been done, Hadamard diagonalizable graphs, those are used in perfect quantum state transfer, and that work was done in 2017 by Steve and other people together. And recently, one new thing that has been considered, that is complex Hadamard diagonalizable graphs. So when the complex Hadamard diagonalizable graphs means they are diagonalizable by a complex Hadamard matrix. So complex Hadamard matrix is it can be a complex matrix, but the entries are with moduli 1, okay, and H into H star, that is the conjugate transpose, should be n times identity. So that is the complex Hadamard matrix. You can take in particular all the entries as plus 1 minus 1 and plus I minus I. That's called Turin Hadamard matrix. Or in particular, if you are taking real, then it will give you plus 1 and minus 1. That's the Hadamard matrix. So for complex Hadamard matrix, which are diagonalizable by complex Hadamard matrix, that has been considered here. And similar graphs are coming out in this work also. This is also a recent article that has been submitted, and it's in archive. So this is what I wanted to tell you. And many problems I just told in between, so they are open. So any problem can be considered by the students who are interested more towards integral eigenvalue graphs. Okay. So thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Susmita, for the interesting talk. Yeah. So participants, if you have questions, you can ask them.
So is there any conditions, ma'am? Obviously Hadamard diagonalizable matrix is regular, right? That is seen from the eigenvector 1, 1, 1.
Hadamard diagonalizable graphs are regular, yeah.
So, but are there any other necessary conditions we have? One is regular, and other than, I think, zero graph, null graph, I think all others are connected, it seems, because eigenvector 1, 1, 1. Is it true?
No, when you are we considered regular co-graph class. In co-graph class, when you are taking a co-graph, both G and G complement, they cannot be connected. So one graph is connected, its complement is again Hadamard diagonalizable, and it's disconnected.
Okay. Are there any other necessary conditions which we can specify?
That is one, that they have integer eigenvalues and even integer eigenvalues. Further, you can observe that when you are taking one Hadamard diagonalizable graph, basically the eigenvectors with half entries plus one, half entries minus one, leaving the first eigenvector. And that form gives a what in a vertex got in your graph. So if you that way, the motivation was also to consider this problem, that when you are taking, so basically you take all positive vertices or all negative vertices, then you have a nice cut for the graph.
Okay. I mean, graph theoretical point of view, can you specify one or two? I mean, so you are telling in terms of eigenvectors. So since the Hadamard matrices itself, they are very demanding, so automatically so many it is restricted. But graph theoretical point of view, regularity is one thing like that. Is there any other conditions of people observed or like that?
No, I am not getting exactly what you wanted to ask. So basically, as I told, they are regular, that's what we are getting. And again, the graph will look like this, for each eigenvector, you can have one, you can just consider positive vertices, negative vertices, that forms a chord. That way the graph can be that's coming. Yeah. And as you observed, it's coming basically, it can be constructed using complete graph. So using join and union operation.
Yes.
That way coming, all the co-graphs mainly, they are coming in that way.
Okay. What are the techniques they are using? They are using now going to combinatorial design theory like Latin squares, and what are the, in general, while constructing these, so general techniques, what they are using?
It's not like Latin square. You can go through the paper that's in archive that gives one algorithm. The algorithm is in different way. You can go through and then you can
That archive paper will help. Thank you.
For other construction, like up to 12 that we constructed, you can see the proof actually. That argument is totally in other way, you can go through the paper.
Right. Okay. Thanks. Thank you very much.
Then, any other questions?
Ma'am, hello.
Yes.
Madam, there are some other papers with eigenvectors entries minus one or plus one or with zero.
Yeah, there are many papers.
Are those related to this Adamant matrices?
No. I just came out. I left zero eigenvalue and then I defined property E. Even property E case has not been solved for graph, and that problem has been settled only for co-graphs, regular co-graphs. When we are considering property E graphs, we know what are they. But then the, for other graphs, property E even it's open. And then when you are allowing zero again, then there are many classes, as I told, that Kelly graphs and GCD graphs all are coming with that, but it's not completely characterized. Few classes are obtained with eigenvectors entry 0, 1 and minus 1. That problem is open, people are working.
Okay, thank you.
Here one thing I can say that any PS operation is playing a role. So the classes which are obtained all are like you can take a complete graphs and do any PS taking a particular basis. So then those graphs are coming out.
Okay. Any other question? But thank you very much, Sasmita, for the interesting talk. Yeah. So I will. Yeah. Please send the slides. I will circulate to the participants.
Yes.
And
okay.
The video also I will upload in the YouTube by tonight.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.